seconds.
I do not believe in belief, but this is an age of faith, and there are so many militant creeds that in self-defense one has to formulate a creed of one's own. Tolerance, good temper, and sympathy are no longer enough in a world which is rent by religious and racial persecution, in a world where ignorance rules, and science, who ought to have ruled, plays the subservient pimp. Tolerance, good temper, and sympathy, they are what matter really, and if the human race is not to collapse, they must come to the front before long.
The voice of Edward Morgan Forster, who died last month at the age of 91. That piece, the opening of an essay called What I Believe, was written during the last war. In many ways, it sums up Forster's attitude. In this program, critics and friends are going to talk about Forster as a novelist, an essayist, as an almost legendary Cambridge figure, as a librettist, and most especially as a man. In an obituary tribute to him on the day he died, Lord Annan, a former provost of Forster's own college, King's Cambridge, had this to say.
He was a mysterious figure in some ways, very modest, very retiring, a mysterious person who lived in seclusion almost at King's College, and yet when he was there, he wasn't in seclusion at all. He was known to people of every age, the young, the undergraduates, and only in his extreme old age did he really retire completely. And even in retirement, his friendship was one of the things that one could never forget, because he was both very loyal to his friends and also very critical, and you had to keep up to the mark. You were frequently deflated if you appeared to be insensitive, because that was the thing that he cared about so much. I think he changed our notions of good and bad in our society more than any other person on what you might call the liberal side, more even than Russell, more even than Shaw. And he changed them because I think he had a greater sensitivity to the complexities of life and to the complexities of morality. And that is why I think he will live as a great force in our literature.
Forster's reputation and influence as a writer depend on a fairly small number of books. In 70 years of active writing, this is his output. 5 novels, a collection of short stories, 4 volumes of essays and criticism, 3 biographical studies, and a most unusual guidebook. Obviously, the novels come first, and it's very important to remember that the first 4 were written and published before the First World War, Where Angels Fear to Tread in 1905, The Longest Journey in 1907, Room with a View in 1908, and Howard's End in 1910. The only other novel, A Passage to India, came out in 1924. In the first 4, the atmosphere of intelligent, liberal, middle-class English society in the Edwardian period is very strong. Their preoccupation with tolerance, understanding, and personal relationships is summed up in the motto of Howard's End, Only Connect. In a recent television dramatization of Howard's End, the 2 sisters, Margaret and Helen Schlegel, played by Glenda Jackson and Sarah Jane Gwilym, state clearly what this means.
Just happened, that's all. Walked through the garden, stood under the witch elm, and I let him kiss me. Said he loved me. Just a chance collision, I suppose.
And in the morning?
In the morning it was over. It was over at once. I knew it was no good when I went into the dining room. There was Evie managing the tea urn, Mr. Wilcox immersed in the Times, Charles talking about stocks and shares, and Paul, just looking frightened. He was mad with terror in case I said the wrong thing. I felt for a moment the whole Wilcox family was a fraud. Just a wall of newspapers, motor cars and golf clubs with nothing behind it but emptiness. Ah, Cousin Frieda's arriving to take you to the Beethoven.
to think that because you and a young man meet for a moment, there must be all these telegrams and anger. The truth is, Helen, there is a world in which telegrams and anger count. Personal relations are not supreme there. There, love means marriage settlements, death, death duties. Do personal relations lead to sloppiness in the end?
Oh, I remember Paul at breakfast. I shall never forget him. Nothing to fall back upon. I know that personal relations are the real life, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the time of his 80th birthday in 1959, the television programme Monitor filmed Forster in Cambridge. He had this to say about the business of writing.
Yeah, I have enjoyed writing. I've never found it a trial or an ordeal of suffering, as some writers do. I'd better add that I'm quite sure I'm not a great novelist, because I've only got down onto paper really three types of people. The person I think I am, the people who irritate me, and the people I'd like to be. When you get to the really great people, like Tolstoy, you find they can get hold of all types. But most novelists, including myself, are much more constricted in their imaginations and their sympathies. We don't get down very much.
Now, Forster saying he's not a great novelist, Lord Annan earlier saying that he's a greater, more important figure than Russell and other distinguished people of the time. Professor Frank Kermode, Professor of English Literature at University College London, how would you place him as a great writer?
Yes, I think he's a great novelist. Certainly he wrote one great novel and four extremely good ones. I'm a little surprised at the claim that he has had such an influence on conduct. I should have thought not. It seems to me the early books where his concern is with English society, with social differences, with money and so on, are very much limited by they're very much of their period. I think a good instance of the kind of failure Forster himself was talking about is, in fact, Leonard Bast in Howards End. His one very determined try to do a poor person who's aspiring to the culture of money, as it were.
Somebody from a class he doesn't know much about.
Someone from a class he does not know much about, so that no one really believes in Leonard Bast, however bold the try is, I think. I should have thought, therefore, that it was coming a little strong to say that looking back at those books, one is anything but a rather small group of people could get a rule of conduct from them.
But this money that Forster had himself, this comfortable middle-class world of his, was, after all, rather inhibiting from his point of view. I mean, why do you say, then, that he's a great writer? Did he ever break out of it?
I think he began to break out of it with Howards End, which was really as far as he could go, I think, looking back, because one has hindsight, in an English milieu. There, the questions of connection were all related to the questions of money and the power of death over money. He's very interested in the power of death and the power of love, too, of course. It's only when we get to Passage to India that we're... and, of course, it is going to India that makes the difference. Here you have separateness, isolatedness. You've got not the gentle but changing English scene as your base, but the earth of India, the rock of India, which is represented as well as flesh of the sun, as something which is hostile to human life completely and forces separation, so that only connect, the motto of Howards End, becomes very eerie, very qualified in the Passage to India.
But does it work? I mean, effectively, is the artistic imagination of Forster greater in this book, as seen through his use of the idea of connection in a more difficult situation?
Oh, very much so. I think connection in A Passage to India fails, in fact. Personal relationships fail in A Passage to India.
Why is it a great book, do you think?
It's a great book because that failure is recorded and ways of challenging it, not permanently successful, but successful in their way, are recorded. The coming of Krishna at the climax of that book is an indication, if you like, of how we live in the world, how we can tolerate life in the world. Moment of ritual, the form of a work of art, like A Passage to India itself, I think, seemed to Forster at that time, and this, I think, is where he exhausted himself as a novelist, incredibly difficult to achieve, and achievable only for that kind of moment And then you fall back, he says, under the rule of time, and the rocks spring up and separate friends, Aziz and Fielding again.
Do you think that the moment for which he was so perfectly suited is over, or do you think he has relevance now for our time?
Oh, I think that a work of this kind will have relevance as long as people, and critics, after all, exist, if they have a reason for existing at all. It's in order to keep on refreshing relevance. Passage to India is a good instance of this. I think it was, though popular, misunderstood, treated as a political novel. It isn't a political novel about India, as Forster himself said. It's a novel about what separates human beings.
But why should we care nowadays about this message of connection? Why should we care in a world which is falling apart?
We care because we live as human beings in a hostile environment and protect ourselves against it by making various constructions of reality. This is one of them, a particularly fine and complete one, I think. So complete as to achieve in its quiet, almost occult way, all the that making of another world, making an image of completeness, which was one of the aims of the great modernist writers. After all, Passage to India came out when Ulysses came out, very roughly speaking. It was swamped because Ulysses' experimental seemed to offer more to other novelists. I think then people will, as time goes by, find that the complexities of Passage to India and the extraordinary beauty of its design is something that slowly becomes evident.
Thank you very much. Cambridge always occupied a central place in Forster's life. In his early years as an undergraduate, later as a supernumerary fellow of King's, and for the last quarter of a century, an honorary fellow. It was a constant thread.
I think it's a place for the very young and the very old. The middle-aged people ought to go away and get other experiences. It's my general feeling about Cambridge. It's quite easy for people of my age to meet undergraduates, and they don't seem to mind. That, I think, is one of the reasons why I'm fond of this place. I don't know how much it's actually helped me in my writing. I don't think it's a place in which a writer ought to remain in. I'm quite sure he ought to go out into the world and meet more types. I was going to say people of more classes, but of course in Cambridge you can now meet people of all classes, but mostly selected intellectuals.
For several generations of King's men, Forster was a familiar part of college life. One of those selected intellectuals was Richard Marquand, who went up in 1955. How did you first meet him, actually?
Well, King's then was a very friendly place. Noel Annan was provost, and he kept it very small and very friendly. And there was a group called the Ten Club, and we used to meet in the rooms of any of the members once a week or once a month, and the host of the evening would provide some food and some wine, and we'd read something that was of interest. And in fact, I met him in his own room on one of these occasions, and he was shuffling around providing food and drink to people.
Did you feel very exclusive, the Ten group?
I think we were possibly a little exclusive. It worries me now, looking back on it. At the time, of course, it was quite an honour.
Was he very shy when he shuffled around?
He was shy and unobtrusive, yes, he was, and one had to sort of help him. Or be bold oneself to break the ice. I remember that well. I lingered on afterwards because I'd not met him before, and I wanted to. And he was glad that I did, and I was glad that
Were you surprised at the first impact of meeting him? Was it different from what you'd expected?
Yes, I think everybody had expected always from a great writer. One had expected something rather more monolithic than one got. Oh, yes, undoubtedly.
Was there a sense of strain there, or was this famous harmony of his, this famous capacity to be tolerant, easy and natural to him?
Tolerance. I think tolerance was easy to him. I think it was upsetting because he was upset by things that happened in the world. I think very much so, possibly from the distance of Cambridge. I don't know. But I remember very well him getting very upset and angry about America's foreign policy, for instance, which he detested. And indeed, he wouldn't allow his books to be filmed because it would almost inevitably involve American money, and he certainly didn't want that sort of invasion. He wanted to hold back as much as possible. And in fact, the American ambassador was asked to dinner at High Table one evening by the provost, and Morgan told me that he wasn't going to go.
Did he get angry with you on a personal level if you didn't come up to his standards in any way?
Well, I remember him once ticking me off for writing him rather bad letters. I'm not a writer at all. And he told me that this was silly, that I, whenever I picked up my pen, it suddenly became awkward and I became a different person, and he said I mustn't do this, and explained that all you have to do is you pick up your pen and you write what you think, which he certainly succeeded in doing, but I never did.
At these meetings in his rooms, did you get the feeling he was consciously being an important person, putting himself out to receive and influence others, young particularly people?
In these meetings, of course not, because on the whole we were friendly, we were friends, and this is really what mattered to him, and he was himself, and he could be totally himself. But I thought he was very brave, really, for a shy man, because he was able to realize that people did in fact want to meet him in his role as a writer rather than in his role as a human being.
But did he need friends? Was it part of his urgent need, do you think?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And in fact, this was something which I think he probably taught me. I think one of the things which is the worst thing about it all is that he's dead, and that we have somehow to carry on. And I think that that's going to be very difficult.
What were his rooms like? Were they very characteristic of him?
He was very nervous about what happened to his rooms at a certain stage, because King suddenly splashed out and were going to decorate the whole thing. And he told me that he was very worried about the wallpaper, because in fact in that monitor film it was all striped and rather sort of Regency and smart. And he got some wild black and gold flowers all over his walls, and he was very worried if they'd really match his books and his pictures and so on. So I told him that they did.
Why do you think he stopped writing? Did you ever get any hint from him, stopped writing novels?
Oh, I think he stopped because he was happy. This letter, I think, shows it as much as anything. I think writers write because they're unhappy. He wrote it from King's in 1963, and the reference to Josephine is, in fact, my wife, who gave him a cap. Dear Richard, still wearing the cap Josephine once embroidered for me, still using the three handkerchiefs, still receiving affectionate invitations from the two of you, who are now three. It really is about time I wrote a line. I'm getting up to London again after hibernating here, and I'd so enjoy calling on you sometime. Let me know just where you live now and what, on the whole, you're doing. I do nothing, but you can't expect... I do nothing, but you can't expect to arrive at Nirvana so soon.
Finally, did you get the feeling he was very cut off in that Nirvana from the modern world, your world as a young man?
He wasn't cut off from my world, no.
Thank you very much. Foster had always loved music. He was an enthusiastic amateur pianist. He also made one direct contribution to English music as a librettist. Having seen and liked Benjamin Britten's opera Peter Grimes, in 1949 they began a collaboration on Herman Melville's story Billy Budd. Foster and Britten, with Eric Crozier as co-librettist, spent a summer at Aldborough working. Benjamin Britten has written of it, "The pleasure I derived from the collaboration I shall never forget. I found his terse, vivid sentences with their strong rhythms melodically inspiring." The story of Billy Budd was well suited to the collaborators, and in the carefully drawn character of Captain Vere, one sees many of Forster's recurrent preoccupations. Here's an extract from the opera, a moment of reflection before Captain Vere tells Billy Budd, the symbol of goodness, that he must die for the murder of Claggett, the symbol of evil. Captain Vere is sung by Peter Pears.
I accept their verdict. I accept their verdict. Death is the penalty of those who break the laws of earth. And I who am king of this fragment of earth, of this floating monarchy, have exacted death. But I have seen the divine judgment of hell. I've seen iniquity cabin. I have beheld the mystery of goodness, and I am afraid. Before what tribunal do I stand? try goodness. The angel of God has struck, and the angel must hang through me. Beauty and misgoodness, it is for me to destroy you.
Pete appears as Captain Vere in Billy Budd. Forster also wrote marvellously perceptive essays and criticism, aspects of the novel, and two collections of shorter articles, Abinger Harvest, which takes its title from his family home in Surrey, and Two Cheers for Democracy, were all published later than any of the novels. It seems in a sense that the commentator took over when the novelist dried up. George Steiner, fellow of Churchill College, Cambridge. Why do you think, in fact, the novelist dried up?
He himself used to say, as you remember, that the world which he had known before the war and its values and style of life had vanished completely. And he said very modestly he was afraid he'd get it wrong if he wrote about things afterwards. I think there's a great deal in this. Perhaps, with hindsight, we could put forward one other more personal conjecture. I think that in his early period of creation, he felt himself, because of his own sexual tastes and beliefs, a very isolated, in some way threatened, person. At the time of a passage to India, he moves into a circle of friends, of like-minded human beings, profoundly in sympathy with him. And it's at least conceivable that something of the spur of anxiety, of the spur of mutiny against his background, begins being less important at that time. He wouldn't be the first very important human being for whom finding happiness is not the best medium for art.
Can you see that the strain of being a homosexual at a time when it was taboo to mention it is visible in the subjects and treatment of the early novels?
Oh, I think very much so, but I would want to put it a little more generally. The strain of being a human being with a code of beliefs and personal behavior of the highest dignity and sensitivity, and not being able to live that openly in any way.
But do you mean he reflects his personal problems, sexual problems, suppressed sexual tastes, in a great conflict in his books between the natural, which he equates with the good, and sort of law?
He reflects a general feeling that he couldn't be himself. And the role of the artist, of the creator, is often a way of stating openly, in the deepest sense of openness, for all of us to hear, what you cannot put graphically.
But if he, when he became himself, got into this circle of friends, and became happy, sexually at any rate, doesn't it show that he's slightly less than the greatest of artists, that he can, in fact, dry up as a result?
I wouldn't accept offhand that not to write novels anymore means drying up. As one looks at the essays he wrote afterwards, the ones you've mentioned, in fact, at everything he wrote right to the end, there are qualities of the highest distinction and insight. I'd almost say he left one form of statement for another.
But the quality of imagination and self-honesty required to write a novel of any importance is greater than that required to write all those essays, surely.
Well, it may be that the quality of disguise needed for a great novel is also greater than the one one needs for writing political and social and literary essays.
Do you think that when the world that he was brought up in and took for granted, a moneyed world, fell apart for him, shifted at any rate, let's say, and the values, social values changed around him, that he was able to feel this connecting thing he talked about in Howards End anymore with the world outside?
No, in a sense, surely, his life and his academic setting are a withdrawal. But that would be to put it, I think, unfairly and much too easily. Because he used to feel and to argue, surely, throughout his wonderful essays, that to connect on the private scale is a very important political act. If we had a word for the kind of anarchy of friendship, for the kind of position which feels, you remember his most famous aphorism, it plagues A-level takers, rather betray one's country than one's closest friend. That famous aphorism actually concentrates a whole body of complicated values. That if you can connect closely with a group of human beings around you, you are doing politics in the finest and deepest sense. And why Two Cheers for Democracy? because for all its liberal virtues, he saw in democracy increasingly the mass element, the standardization of human relations.
But that's like saying if I decorate my house beautifully, those who are lucky enough to be invited into it might benefit from my taste, surely. In a sense, one could argue that Forster had abdicated, surely.
In a sense, but one could almost say that the plea goes the other way. Please decorate your own house as best you love it. Not beautifully according to my standards, he's saying. I don't think anything that simple. But do your own thing, as the modern slang is. And if you do it with complete intensity and are lucky enough to find a human being near you who agrees, you have constructed a very powerful unit against barbarism. And that was his supreme value during all those years.
But how can you connect, to finally get onto that subject for the last time, how can you connect with other human beings at all unless you commit yourself to the situation around you?
Because
one way or the other.
The situation around you need not be a political mass situation. It may be precisely the hammering out of a number of personal relations which will be so intensely lived and so fairly experienced that other human beings derive strength from them. And surely in his case, he was lucky enough to let a lot of other human beings feel what he was doing.
What about his reputation abroad?
That's a very difficult question. Very great in India and Ceylon, I understand. But if you were to ask me, is in a class with those whose books are in everybody's pocket today, Camus, Hermann Hesse, D.H. Lawrence, no, much smaller than that. And just to look to the nearest quarter, if you and I were talking in Paris tonight and using the name by which he's been referred to so often, Morgan, I'm afraid even our more literate hosts would think we were talking of Charles Morgan.
George Steiner, thank you very much. Those who were fortunate enough to have known him personally all paid tribute to his capacity for friendship. He was as good at giving as receiving. Let's close this program, then, with a contribution from a friend of nearly 40 years standing, the novelist Christopher Isherwood, who saw Forster for the last time only a couple of months before his death.
You know, when you're in the in contact with somebody like this extraordinary man, one of the ways that you realize it is that you are quite incapable of the meaner feelings that you sometimes get in relation to other people, of envy, of jealousy. Morgan had all sorts of friends, he had all sorts of deep relations with various people. But I'm quite sure of one thing, that his friendship enclosed us all, and we never felt that anything was being taken away from one to give to another. When I saw him just the other day, as it seems, he was, of course, outwardly decrepit. He couldn't walk well, and he was stooped, but he looked basically the same, and he was basically the same. And he was curiously and marvelously accepting what was happening. There was no pathos, nothing at all. He said, oh, I hope I'll pop off quickly. When I do, he said. And then he said, you know, sometimes I feel empty, as if my creative power had come to an end. But he said, I don't mind. And I said to him, you know, Morgan, 25 years ago, you once said to me, you said, as I get older, I hope I shan't get depressed. And you thought to yourself for a little and then answered yourself and said, no, I don't think I shall. And he didn't.
Thank you. Hello, darling.
Where the dickens have you been? I think it's very inconsiderate of you to go wandering off on your own. Me and Ern have been worried silly.
What do you mean, wandering off? You were the ones who left me standing at the side of the road. Where is Ernie, anyway? I want a word with him.
Oh, well, he's gone back again to look for you.
Oh, no. He'll go spare if he gets there and can't find me.
Well, I'm not leaving here again, lady, till I've had a couple of pints.
Here, why don't you lend your bike to Mr. Latwick? Then he can nip back down the road and find his son-in-law.
What, him? You must be joking.
Nah, he's just been telling me. He used to be a dispatch rider in the army. That was before he was a squadron leader in the Air Force and a captain in the Navy.
He thinks he can handle it. I am completely familiar with these machines, young man. I was riding them before you was born.
Oh, yeah, then. Cop hold.
Oh, thank you.
You're not going without me, Dad. I'm not getting separated again.
Come on, then.
Are you sure you've ridden one of these things before, Dad?
Of course. It's just that I'm more used to stunt work, that's all.
Thanks again. Won't be long.
No rush, love. Take your time. I won't be bored. I've got something to do.